Almighty God, author, giver of life, you are our friend and our brother, even though you are our king. Help us to love you more than any other, more than anything. Help us to want you more than gold or silver. Help us to learn that only you can satisfy, that you alone are the real joy giver and the apple of our eyes. May this be true in the words that we are about to hear from your word as explained through your spirit, through your servant, Pastor Mike, and as we move out from this place into the world around us. In your name we pray, amen. Thank you.
Well, for our guests that are here with us this morning, we normally don't talk about what whales do.
If it makes sense, think about it.
I'm trying to stop thinking about it. But we do try to have an authentic atmosphere, and I pray that is a mark of authenticity. I don't know. But no, we've had a very interesting morning so far in so many ways. I've ridden the roller coaster of emotions already this morning, from deep sadness to great joy and praise and thanksgiving. So isn't that what we should be doing as the family of God? It's the bride of Christ, is to bearing up one another, sharing each other's burdens, rejoicing when rejoicing is necessary, and not feeling so territorial that we can't send off family. So someone else want to talk for a second? Happy for you guys. So there comes the sadness part again. So, and actually, even on a day like today, there's sadness in the background of our minds as we think about it, even what our country went through 15 years ago. So, I have this in my notes. This isn't merely because I'm tearing up right now, but I wanted to have a time of prayer where it's not me leading, but I'll be quiet. But you guys speak up, and let's pray for our nation, but let's do so as Christians, as we want to see the families that today have just a tinge of hurt and sorrow in their minds about what happened 15 years ago. Let's pray that the comfort of Christ would be real to them today. Let's pray that the churches that were packed that first Sunday after September 11th would become packed again, and for the right reasons. Mm-hmm. People knew that they could come to a church for comfort and healing and grace, because that's the Savior we serve. And I just pray that, boy, that'd be so wonderful to see that again for the right reasons, and that people would come and stay because they have found the Savior to be who He promised He was in the Word. So with all that introduction, let's have a time of prayer as we think about the families that have lost people on 9/11, as well as even in the war sense. Let's pray for safety for our troops, our men and women that are bravely fighting for the freedom that we're expressing right here this morning, to worship, to gather freely without fear of persecution, and to be able to walk in the front doors and not worry about them saying that's a Christian place going on there. We need to do something about stopping that. Let's pray for the safety of our men and women, of our armed forces, as well as our men and women who keep us safe here within our own borders. So let's have a time of prayer where I invite you guys to speak up and pray corporately as we just petition our Lord for a renewed sense of revival, for His Spirit to fall on us, as well as healing and comfort that's found in Christ.
Lord Jesus, you have been so gracious to us. You have lifted us up when we were so far down. You showed us grace while we were still sinners. You died for us. And yet, Lord, so often we forget to show that grace that you have so abundantly showered on us, those around us. And so they begin to think of the church as being hostile, condemning, angry. Lord Jesus, I pray that your grace will just pour out upon us, so that we, in turn, can give that grace to our neighbors, so that they can see your love, feel your love, understand what your grace means, and that it can have meaning in their lives, that they can grow in you, Lord Jesus, that they'll come to you and worship you and give thanks for your grace, and then, in turn, also bestow grace upon those that they know, and that they love, and that they come in contact with. Lord Jesus, we are so selfish. So often we aren't content to sit here in church, and so can your blessing, and so hesitant to go out to the world. I pray, Lord Jesus, that your church, the body of Christ will reach out to all people. They will distribute your grace, and that we can learn to love and to give and to care as you.
Lord, I'm so thankful for the many servicemen and women who felt called to serve our country and listen. Thank you for all they did to protect our freedoms and help us to cherish that by exercising our freedoms for wanting to worship. This doesn't happen in so many places in the world, and sometimes we grumble, but help us to just be feeling so joyful about the ability to worship and to freely serve you and speak of you.
Lord, in this election year, I pray for the leadership of our country. Lord, it's sometimes so difficult to sort out all of the things that are going on. And I just pray that in this situation, your will be done. That you will take control of this, and that you will surround the leaders of our country with Christian voices and with the right decision making, so that whatever the outcome of this election, your hand will be upon it and your people will be with you. Lord, I just pray that the churches will spend time in prayer over what's going to be coming up, and that the leadership will be given strength and support.
Lord, draw us back to being a godly nation. Lord, the ache that all of us have deep within our spirit can only be filled by you. I pray, Lord, that we seek you first. We seek your kingdom first. No matter who our president is, no matter who our leaders are, you are our king. Mm-hmm. Let us not waver in the faith and the peace that that alone brings.
Father, I pray for missionaries who are working, especially with Muslims. I pray that the Holy Spirit will just go ahead of them so that the words they say, the missionaries say, will just hit home.
Lord, I thank you for who you are, and I just ask that you will comfort all the families in their losses. I thank you for all the ones that have served and lost their lives, and the ones that are still serving to give us our freedom. Just, Lord, just guide us and protect us.
Lord, we ask for healing for the men and women who have returned, who have PTSD.
Gracious, loving Father, you have sent us forgiveness in the form of God in flesh, and you did so not waiting for us to be deserving, but as an act of mercy and grace and the greatest act of love. Father, thank you so much for protecting what he did for us, what you did for us in Christ, in form of the gospel of Jesus Christ that we get to share with others, that we get to live under, and that we get to try to hold ourselves obedient to. So Father, help us as a church to be a church that is strong in the essentials of the faith and strong in love as Christ loves sacrificially and wholly with his entire being. and not withhold back anything, Lord, that can be used of you. To consider everything about us, our personalities, our time, our talents, our resources, everything about us, Lord, at your disposal for the furthering of your kingdom. Father, we had a great opportunity when you brought many into the doors of churches around this nation 15 years ago. And Father, while I'm sure the reason why many didn't stick around is multifaceted, but Lord, help us to never have it be a fault of us not preaching the gospel. Let us be strong in the gospel and in the right gospel, the gospel of Jesus Christ, which so amazingly cuts to the center of our being, provides us salvation, forgiveness of sins, absorbs the wrath, your wrath, justly deserved, and put it on Christ so that we could be granted entrance into your beautiful eternal kingdom. Lord, for that and so many other blessings, we praise you and thank you this morning. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. Not merely for the sake of time, because I honestly think that the Word of God should hold a place of prominence in our lives, but the way this morning has gone on, we're just going to go ahead and move through 2 Corinthians 11, but in a different fashion than what I planned, so don't worry about slides. If you see I'm sticking behind, I got a thumbs up, all right, good, because they may not pertain to what we're going to talk about directly this morning, but I spent the week in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, and this text is, again, in the worship planning of God, is so apropos for us this morning that when I was going through it, the reality of what Christ has for us through the lips of Paul is just amazing. And it is about being truthful, being loyal, having fidelity to the gospel of Christ. And if there's anything that us Christians, we need to strengthen ourselves up on constantly, every single day, it's being firm in the gospel of Jesus Christ, because it's in that we have our identity. It's in Christ's place, in our place of Christ on the cross, where he stood in our place, that we have our identity. A sinner in need of a Savior, and that has been accomplished. And then he grants us this glorious sealing of the Holy Spirit to make our salvation sure. And that's a glorious truth for us this morning, that we need to stand rock solid on the gospel. And Paul pulls no punches in this chapter. This is, Galatians is sharp. Galatians, he says, oh, foolish Galatians, you're leaving the gospel again. This, he goes even further. He is very sharp and almost scathing in this chapter for those that are purposely perverting the gospel. And we have to remember that the context of 2 Corinthians 11 is Paul talking to the church. So this is a family meeting. This is a house. We're going to get this house in order before we even worry about what's going on out there. And that's ultimately, the way we need to read this, because I can read this and say, that's what's wrong out there. You guys screwed up Christ. You got the wrong Jesus, because that's everywhere. We see his name's on buildings that don't preach the gospel. We see his name being presented as merely a literary character of fiction just to promote some form of moral code that is now outdated and old. And we see him saying, oh, he actually was a historical guy. He was a pretty peaceful dude. He loved. And that's not the Jesus of the Bible. Yes, he loved, but it's not some mamby-pamby Hallmark Channel movie love. It is real love. It is, I'm going to die for you love that he has for us. And Paul does here in 2 Corinthians 11 is, let's get our house in order. Let's make sure we got the gospel right. Because I pointed out, this is Paul speaking, I'm actually paraphrasing him. Paul's saying, I pointed out to you where you've erred, where you've allowed in this heresy, where you allowed somebody to pervert my Christ, the true Christ. The Christ of the gospel should be so precious to us that we want to fight for his fidelity in our church. That's where we get strong. And that's where when people come in, and let's say, God forbid, another tragic accident or terrorist attack happens again and this place is packed. But if it is, let us be strong in the gospel so that they hear the truth. And they're convinced by the truth, not convinced by fancy music, which clearly we don't have. We don't have light shows and fog machines, anything else. It's not having convinced to some seeker-sensitive message that makes you feel comfortable. No, because we need to afflict the comfortable and comfort the afflicted. The gospel does both. The gospel is healing. The gospel also afflicts me and says, that sin is wrong. Bring it under the ownership of Christ. And I'm going to give you the power to help you do that with the Holy Spirit. That's what the gospel, let them stick around because we have the right gospel. And that's my call for me. That's my call for you to hold me accountable. That's my call for you guys to hold each other accountable. And I will seek to hold you guys accountable to that too. And Paul's getting at it here in 10. He began by saying, there's still some of you that haven't repented. There's still some of you that I want you to be in the fellowship of Christ. And he uses some amazing imagery in 11. I titled my sermon for this morning, The Father of the Bride, because, well, first of all, we're Christians, so we like that movie, right? That's one of our movies we like. But second of all, Paul uses that to describe his jealousy. So 2 Corinthians 11, verse 1 begins, I wish you would bear with me in a little foolishness. Do bear with me, for I feel a divine jealousy for you, since I betrothed you to one husband to present you as a pure virgin to Christ. Last week, he said, I've got divine weaponry so that you can fight sin. Here he's saying, I got divine jealousy. We can be jealous as Christians, not over our neighbor's ox or our neighbor's wife. No, we can have jealousy over the true gospel. I am jealous of the people that fall underneath the sway of the false gospel because they're so close, but they're not close enough. They don't have the right Jesus. He was a real historical character, but he was also God in flesh. He is a God, but he doesn't give you godhood. You don't get your own planet. I am jealous for the fidelity, the truthfulness, the loyalty of the gospel of Christ, because there is no other, because it is an exclusive claim, because John 14:6 is still in my Bible, that he is the way, the truth, the life, and no one comes to the Father except through him. I'm jealous for that Jesus. That's who my life should be centered upon. That's who, and I fail every day just like you guys. That's who I need to preach. That's who I need to believe and to understand. And that's who I see Paul fighting for. And he says the church is like a bride, his daughter essentially, that he's presenting to the bridegroom. And that should hit the fathers of daughters in this room, their ears especially. That should hit all of our ears especially. We've all been to weddings. Weddings are a picture of the relationship between Christ and the church. And that is why we love weddings that preach the gospel, because it is Christ coming for his church embodied. It is taking a covenant. It's that I am so reliant upon you, I'm going to feed you. We make that a joke. We smear cake in each other's faces. No, that's I am utterly reliant upon you. It becomes an opportunity to be funny. Ha ha, I smeared cake in your face. No, that is a picture of I am relying upon you. That is an Old Testament covenant thing that was going on. They cut the covenant. The walking down the center aisle between two halves sounds like what? Particular covenant in the Old Testament to anybody? Right? Animals cut in half? This is so rich. So Paul's saying here, he's hitting some ears. If they're familiar, there were Jewish people in Corinth. It was predominantly Gentile, but he's hitting ears here because that marriage was known. I am jealous for you because I wanted to present you as a bride, undefiled, to the bridegroom. And there is some really amazing imagery of weddings and us being the bride of Christ. You know that the idea of the church as the bride of Christ is actually, people will say that it's not an accurate image. Because we're also the body of Christ. How can we be the body and the bride? Well, I say, well, he's also the door. Jesus is the door. And he's also the Lamb of God. How can the Lamb? So we can't go down that road and start to see this. Because in 2 Corinthians 11, it is clear that he is presenting the church as the bride of Christ. But elsewhere, if you wanted to turn to Ephesians 5, Ephesians 5 has really great imagery for us. In verse 25, I'll begin. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. That is church as bride there. And how did Christ love the church? He gave himself up for her. It is on the confession of Jesus Christ as Savior, the Son of God, the Savior, that Jesus built the church. That's the rock of our, the cornerstone of our church. So husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of the water with the word, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. Jesus Christ is the sanctifying power for our fighting to be more like Christ. That's the divine warfare, the weaponry that Paul was talking about in 10. We have divine weaponry at our disposal to become more and more like Christ. Why? Because Christ is sanctifying us so that he can present us to himself. Mind, that's paradigm shifting. He's doing it so he can present us to himself. We have that great of a God. He's working in us. He's going to wash us with his blood. He's going to cloak us in his righteousness so that when you stand before God on judgment day, he doesn't see you, he sees Christ. And that imagery becomes pretty clear in Revelation 19. Revelation 19. Figure out where I want to start. Let's go Revelation 19:6 if you're turning in your Bibles. Then I heard what seemed to be, this is John speaking, then I heard what seemed to be a voice of a great multitude, like the roar of many waters and like the sound of mighty peals of thunder crying out, Hallelujah! Praise the Lord. Hallelujah, for the Lord our God, the Almighty, reigns. Let us rejoice and exalt and give him the glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come and his bride has made herself ready. How did her bride, the church, make herself ready? Because it was granted her to clothe herself with fine linen, bright and pure. For the fine linen is the righteous deeds of the saints. And the angel said to me, write this. Blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he said to me, these are the true words of God. We are in the engagement period at this point. But it's not a perpetual engagement. It will end and it will culminate when Christ comes again in glory. It's at that moment that the engagement ends. Technically, the offer of salvation is over with. We want as many people at the marriage supper of the Lamb as possible. It's like one of the prayers I heard someone say, let us not just become here to get comfortable on Sundays. Oh, let us prepare. Let us soak in. Let us encourage one another. Let us edify one another. Let us challenge one another. But let us do that so that we go out, because we are the sent ones to go. And while going, that's a verb there that has ongoing action in the Great Commission of Matthew 28, while going, make disciples, teaching them all that Christ has commanded us, and baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Bringing them into the marriage supper of the Lamb. I watched a video by Ray Comfort this 2 weeks ago. It's about an hour long, so I don't know if maybe we'll split it up between two Sunday school classes. It is so good. Ray Comfort is a guy who goes out and lovingly preaches one-on-one to people. He preaches open air, but he also witnesses one-on-one to people in Santa Monica Pier, California. Just as a neat guy who loves people and wants to see. He's passing out invitations to the marriage supper of the Lamb left and right. Like, come to the Savior, repent and trust in him. And he was talking to an older gentleman, probably in his late 70s, early 80s. And if you're in your late 70s, early 80s, I didn't mean any disrespect saying he was older. But he was talking to this gentleman, and he was an atheist, was a staunch atheist. And his biggest fear about if heaven is real was, I'm going to be bored there. And Ray Comfort said, you are not going to be bored there. Mindy and I have done a terrible job essentially saying that heaven's just going to be, he says, a bunch of people on clouds with rusty harps. That is not heaven. Heaven is us praising and worshiping God with mind, soul, spirit that is undefiled by sin. What we have a hard time doing on Sunday for an hour and a half, or if you come to Sunday school, maybe 3 hours or so, is going to be painless in heaven. Worshiping God with undefiled hearts, hearts undivided, unified hearts, looking at the glory of God in Christ, who's reached down through time into eternity to save you. So that when you have all that time, you can look back and think of all those sins that your Savior has saved you from and worship and glorify him all the more. Talk about a heart full of thanksgiving and of gratitude towards the Savior who has saved you. And that every single one of those sins was not merely just stamped forgiven. It was stamped forgiven, not by an ink pad or a well of ink just full of some black substance. It was the blood of Christ. So that when you think about Good Friday, when you think about the stripes on Christ's back, that was for you. That was for that sin. Your God, who knows the end from the beginning, knew what you would commit and put that on Christ. Gone, forgiven, separated. Left for you to worship and praise him. So then you ask yourself, well, then where do I come into this equation? Repent. Admit with God that you are a sinner, that you are in need of a Savior, because there is one God, the only way, the only truth, the only life, and the only way to the Father, which is through Jesus Christ. Admit with God. That's an easier way of saying repent. Turn from your sins and turn to God. Knowing and trusting, having faith in Jesus Christ as being your sacrifice for your need for salvation, so that when you see the ink on your passport saying forgiven, you notice that it's got that hue of red of Christ's blood for you. The cross has so much greater meaning at that point. It wasn't merely as an example to show sacrifice and giving a lot. That's part of it. But he's sacrificing and giving for you, for your sins. The specific ones that I don't know about, no one else in here knows about. The one you think you've hidden. Because nothing's hidden from God. That one, forgiven. Doesn't that strengthen your sanctification? Christ working in you to make you more like him so that he can present you in the church to himself? It's pretty interesting. When you start to look at the way the Bible presents this, there's not a whole lot here that we're responsible for when it comes to salvation. Our responsibility comes afterwards. It's working with the Holy Spirit. It's trying not to dull our senses to the Holy Spirit. When he says, don't do that, saying, no, that's going to be really good. I got to do it, God. And then believing the lie of Satan, the master of lies, which is what Paul says about the gospel that these super apostles were preaching in Corinth. That's what he gets on about. So after just going at the church saying, I'm like your father, you're like the bride, I want to present you undefiled to the perfect bridegroom, Christ, the one who will not let you down, because we screw up marriage in our day and age, we screw up relationships, we can get the idea of just someone's going to let someone down. Not the case. You've got a perfect covenant partner. Just like God was the only one to walk through the covenant ceremony of Abraham, he was the only responsible part of that covenant, couldn't fail, so too can your covenant cannot fail with Christ. And he wants to present you as a pure virgin to Christ. And he says, but I'm afraid, in verse 3 of chapter 11 of 2 Corinthians, but I'm afraid that as the serpent deceived Eve by his cunning, your thoughts will be led astray from a sincere and pure devotion to Christ. For if someone comes and proclaims another Jesus, there's an early warning that we need to heed today. If someone comes and proclaims another Jesus than the one we proclaimed, or if you receive a different spirit from the one you received, or if you accept a different gospel from the one you accepted, you put up with it readily enough. He's like, I'm dad talking here, bride. Be true to the guy that asked for the engagement, and I said, sure, ask for my daughter's hand in marriage. Be true to him. That's the pure, true bridegroom. Don't fall for another gospel. They bring another spirit. They have another Jesus. Verse 5, indeed, I consider that I'm not in the least inferior to these super apostles. That's been their claim all along. That's how they got into Corinth. Paul? Oh, you guys are into the gospel of Paul? The guy that doesn't speak really well? Probably walks with a limp, the scars all over his back. Pretty skinny because he's been shipwrecked and starving and without food. Bags under his eyes because he doesn't sleep too well because he's anxious for his church because he wants to present them as the pure bride. That Paul? The weak guy? Did he accept money from you guys when he preached? He didn't accept money from you? Probably because he knew he was inferior. Probably because he knew he didn't have what it took to be an apostle. You're collecting for Jerusalem. You want to help out the saints? Well, stop that. Your wealth is a sign of God's power on you. Hold on to that. Don't give that to Jerusalem. Paul's like, what? No. You're departing from the true gospel. In fact, God's power, I'll jump to it now, God's power from 16 to the end of the chapter in 33 is shown to him in weakness. He's continuing on in almost the same vein, verse 19. He says, for you gladly bear with fools. Paul first started this by saying, let me be a fool. Let me boast to you. Because that's what the super apostles were doing. I'm going to boast about my ability to speak, my power, my health. I can talk really well. I've got good health. I don't need extra sleep. I don't have bad eyesight. So he's saying, yeah, I'll boast. I'll boast like a fool, but a totally different fool than what you guys are talking about. So since many of you, the church in Corinth, according to the flesh, you accept that those that are boasting to you, I too will boast. For you gladly bear with fools, being wise yourselves. For you bear with it if someone makes slaves of you or devours you or takes advantage of you or puts on airs or strikes you in the face. To my shame, I must say, we were too weak for that. False gospel enslaves you. It lies to you. It slaps you in the face. And don't turn the other cheek on that. But what anyone else dares to boast of, I'm afraid, I'm speaking of as a fool. I also dare to boast of that. Are they Hebrews? So am I. They want Jewish lineage? I got it. The Pharisee of Pharisees. Are they offsprings of Abraham? So am I. Are they servants of Christ? I'm a better one. He's got the right Christ. I'm talking like a madman, he says. See, I'm talking about this is raw Paul scathing here. With far greater labors, far more imprisonments, with countless beatings, and often near death. 5 times I received the hand from the hands of the Jews, the 40 lashes less one. 3 times I was beaten with rods. Once I was stoned, don't think Denver or Washington State. Three times I was shipwrecked a night and a day. I was adrift at sea on frequent journeys in danger from rivers, dangers from robbers, dangers from my own people, dangers from Gentiles, dangers in the city, dangers in the wilderness, danger at sea, danger from false brothers and toil and hardships through many a sleepless night and hunger and thirst, often without food and cold and exposure. Apart from other things, there is the daily pressure of my anxiety on me for all the churches. Who is weak and I'm not weak? Who is made to fall and I'm not indignant? If I must boast, I'll boast of the things that show my weakness. And why? Jump over to 12:9. Christ said to him, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. And that's weakness admitted. That's weakness realized. That's repentance. God, I can't fight that sin. God says, you're right. My grace is sufficient for you. I've got you. Turn to me. Go read 2 Corinthians 12:9 when you're tempted. My grace is sufficient for you. My power is made strong in your weakness. When you come to the end of yourself, that's when Christ is most magnified in you. Love that, Jesus. Not cheapen by putting a price tag on. Oh, it's going to get you rich. Back again. Apostles up here dancing on money during our offering. No. No, your riches are in heaven. And don't even get, like, blindsided by gold streaks. That'll be, if they're true, cool. It's going to be the riches of Christ's righteousness, his sinlessness, his perfection, his forgiveness that he offered you. It's going to be at the marriage supper of the Lamb where he welcomes you in as a member of his bride. Bridal party, you can call it. Oh, what a glorious Savior. And Paul's fighting for him here because he says when we stray from that, go back to 2 Corinthians 11, verse 12. When we stray from that, this is Paul, and what I am doing, I will continue to do. This is Paul talking like, I'm going to stay bold with you. And what I am doing with you, I will continue to do in order to undermine the claims of those who would like to claim that in their boasted mission, they work on the same terms as we do. Boast all you want, guys, super apostles. You're not boasting of the same things. You're boasting of stuff I can measure by checking a bank account status or your chart at the doctor's office if HIPAA laws weren't in place. Verse 13, for such men are false apostles. Deceitful workmen, Paul's gloves off. Deceitful workmen disguising themselves as apostles of Christ. We've got Halloween coming up pretty soon. We're going to have kids disguising themselves joyfully as things that they, when their imaginations are running wild. Pretty harmless for the most part. These guys were disguising themselves as apostles of Christ. Because they knew that they totally changed it. We're not going to buy it. I got to do a little bit like Paul, but then point out where Paul is wrong. Disguising themselves as apostles of Christ. They're deceitful. They're liars. Verse 14, and no wonder, for even Satan disguises himself as an angel of light in 15, one of the most haunting verses in this whole book. So it is no surprise if his servants, Satan, the angel of light, his servants also disguise themselves of service as servants of righteousness. Their end will correspond to their deeds. Christ didn't die on a cross to save you from a headache for a couple thousand years. He didn't die on the cross because you had a hangnail and you took that little bit of pain away. He died because there is eternal conscious torment at stake in here, and that's just because we have a perfect, holy God who's created this world. Paul doesn't want anyone in Corinth to fall away from the truth because he knows what their end is. And he's saying those super apostles, their deeds will correspond to their deeds. When we allow a perversion of the gospel in, that is precisely where Satan is the master, skewing it just a little bit. I think, honestly, Satan looks at devil worshippers, the ones that are, quote, devil worshippers, and pecks them on the back and says, that's cute. That's cute. No, where I'm working is when I skew and I tell you that Jesus was just a prophet. Jesus is just one of many gods. In fact, you can be like him. Jesus was a moral dude. Preaching love. Like the original hippie. Jesus was just a literary character designed to put women in bondage and to get white men, even though he was Arabic, maybe from the Middle East, to get power and all that other things. No, Jesus is God of very God. Took on human flesh, not sacrificing any bit of his deity, taking on being fully God so that he could live the life that you could not live. He could live the sinless life. He could face the temptations that you faced, and far greater because he had Satan talking directly to him, trying to skew God's word, his best trick. steer it just a little bit like he did Eve, you open up the chapter. That's where Satan is masterful. That's why we hold to the true Christ. That's why we hold and we want to be true and have great fidelity to the true Christ, because he's the one who bought us. He's the one who saved us. That's the Christ that we should be exemplifying and living out in our lives. And I know we do, but let's do it even better and more often. Myself included. Because I know myself better than I know you guys. That's who we need to do. Who do you need to demonstrate? That's true love. That's not make love not war love. That is, I'm going to die for you love. Sacrificial love. That's the epitome of love. If he is love, then he can define love, and we have to work under his definitions, and that's the way he is defined. That's the Christ that I want people to encounter when they walk through these doors. As you are greeting them, as you are welcoming into their fold, as we are sharing one another burdens, as we have to painfully say goodbye to people. But I pray that when they leave here, for the right reasons, that we know that they're going out having heard the right gospel and that they find another truth. And that's what we'll pray for the Veals for the next couple months, that they'll find a church that preaches the true gospel of Christ. And we're so lucky to live in a town where that's preached many places. Delton Community Church does not have the exclusive rights on the gospel. It's a franchise where we're happy to be a part of. We have many great gospel partners in this town. I've made good friends with Pastor Bunch, with Pastor Miller at Interlakes Baptist, with Pastor Slater at Doster Reformed Church. That's Reformed, that's Baptist, Methodist, and the non-denom all getting along. That is the work of Christ.
That's right.
Because we got it right, but I mean, we'll get them all along. They'll all be non-denoms. No, I'm kidding. We have visitors here. So that's not true. We're not drinking. We want to be true to our God who saved us. And that's my prayer for as we leave here today, that we have a God who has loved us, who has saved us, and did so sacrificially. And that's the gospel we preach. We want to be true to the true gospel, to preach the true Christ, so that we have the true Spirit of Christ, the Holy Spirit present here, because we're under his authority. We're trying to lead with his example, and it's trying to hold every thought captive to Christ, as he told us last. So that's my prayer. As we leave here today, let us be Christians who are about the gospel of Christ. That's going to look different with your personality than it will with mine. That's going to look different with your giftedness than mine. That's going to look different in your workplace than mine. I happen to work in a workplace where the gospel is pretty well accepted. Yeah. Leave that one alone too. So that is my encouragement for us this morning, that today is a sad day for many reasons, but it also is a bright day, because today is the day the Lord has made and we should rejoice and be glad in it. Let us think of ourselves as the bride of Christ, individually, collectively, and church universal, and seek to be true to our bridegroom, Jesus Christ, because we have that great, glorious day in the future where we get to have a marriage supper, and where we celebrate his fidelity to us, and even our acts of righteousness as well, which of course were done by him. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we have many thoughts and emotions running through our minds this morning, celebrating the moving up and the aging of some of our kids, sadly celebrating the moving out of a dear beloved family of our church, but Lord, we know that they are brothers and sisters of Christ, and that whenever we see them, whenever they walk through our doors or we run into them for coffee, we know that we'll be able to give them, greet them with a holy kiss. Father, we thank you for Christ. We thank you for preserving the gospel. Lord, help us to be students of your gospel. Help us to be ambassadors of your gospel. Help us to be examples of your gospel. And Lord, not so that we become well known, but so that we become known well as a follower of Christ. Lord, give us the courage to be a lamp on a hill, to be a beacon of the truth, and to not only wait for people to come in, but to be proactive and go out and reach people in the community with our own unique skills that you've given us. We ask all of this in the precious name of Jesus Christ. And all of God's people said,
Amen.